time to move from Boston to Chicago, and Bernie Hertline will start talking about some of his experience with the reuse of foundations in an urban redevelopment. Bernie, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Gerald. The sustainable movement, for want of a better word, is taking a firm hold of the deep foundations discipline. And for urban redevelopment, there is a lot of questions raised about whether it's whether deep foundations from existing structures have been replaced or reused. One of the reasons for this, why are we even thinking about this kind of challenge and the risks, is simply the density of modern cities. This is Chicago. You can see there's not much that hasn't already been built on. It's very rare that you find a piece of land that hasn't already got something buried underneath it. And the challenge is it safe to reuse it? Obviously, there's a lot of people that are very concerned about the risks of reusing an unknown piece of structure to support something like the buildings you see in this photograph. Existing foundations vary. As I said, most urban redevelopment projects encounter them. And they usually conflict with the proposed new foundation design, particularly like in the Chicago area, where bell shafts are fairly common. You can't just drill a hole beside an existing foundation to put in a new one, because the chances are you're going to bump into the bell. So these things have to be identified and planned for. Removal and disposal costs are often prohibitive. You're talking about trucking material out of a city like Chicago. It's not a cheap prospect. And reuse, where practical, obviously offers financial and environmental benefits. And the environmental benefits are something I want to focus on a little bit here, because they don't often get considered or mentioned, but they are very real. The reasons for examining foundations the way we do is because the designer needs to know about the durability and the capacity. Can he use it? What sort of loads can he put on it? And how reliable is it? To estimate some of these things, a lot of other information, corollary information, is needed. First of all, what type of foundation is it? In Chicago, we've got all sorts, from the old timber foundations through sheet piles, steel tube foundations, steel pipe, concrete filled steel pipe, precast driven piles, drill shafts of all shapes and sizes. We need to know what depth. As I'll show you later, Chicago's got a pretty complex soil system, and the depth is a critical piece of the one of the critical clues when it comes to estimating the capacity of a foundation. The condition of the foundation needs to be known. If it's steel, is it corroded, as John showed earlier with the files in Boston? Is it concrete? Has it been suffered from any kind of degradation? If it's timber, has it rotted? All these things, in many cases, dependent on the soil conditions, so we need to know those too. So an integrated approach is what's needed. There are a number of invasive methods we can use. Like the crudest one is simply pull the foundation out and take a look at it. Not always practical, especially with the larger foundation. Digging test pits. This can tell you something about the soils and the foundation, but only near the surface. It's difficult in most areas to dig deep test pits without significant shoring, water control, et cetera, et cetera. So test pits are very limited in what they can tell you. Soil borings are helpful, but how many can you afford to do over a large site where you know the soils are likely to be complex? That's where CPT soundings come in. CPT soundings correlated with soil borings can greatly extend your knowledge of the soils and give you a much higher confidence level of what you're standing on. And the pressure meter. This is something that's, I don't want to call it new, but it's not very well known to many engineers, but it does give you another critical piece of information about the soils at depth. Again, I will show later. Non-invasive methods for assessing foundations There are some non-destructive testing methods out there, but the proper use of those requires knowledge of how they function. We'll come to that shortly. Proof loading. In many cases, as in the case of the Boston Foundations, you can test them, load test them, and satisfy yourself as to what it can take. In some cases, the demolished building, if you know enough about it, can be considered a proof load. You know how the foundation behaved with that much load on it. So can you use that in your future design calculations? Now, the non-destructive testing is one of the less understood things here that I'm going to spend a little time on, because it's essential to understand the principles in order to have realistic expectations of what the test is going to tell you. There is no silver bullet. The simplest methods are the impulse methods, where basically you instrument the top of the shaft and tap on it with a hammer. The simplest of these is the sonic echo. Somewhat more complex is the sonic mobility, which does a frequency analysis rather than a time-based analysis. And then there are the acoustic methods. Parallel seismic relies on the propagation of a sound wave down through the foundation. Cross-hole sonic logging generates a sound wave through the foundation horizontally. And the electromagnetic methods come into it. We have the magnetometry, which is just what it sounds like. It's a magnetic detector that can be lowered, scanned over the surface or lowered down a borehole, or in some cases, ground penetrating radar. It has its uses, but it's very limited in this particular application. And we'll take a look at the physical properties of these methods, the physical principles, to get a better understanding of what may help you and what won't. The impulse echo, nice simple method, originally developed for precast driven piles in uniform soils, in which situation it functions very well. It does need access to the top of the shaft. You have to be able to tap on the top and instrument the top with a receiver to be able to perform the test. So if you're under a grade beam or large cap, you would have to remove that to be able to get out the shaft. It's very fast and economical to perform, but the only information you get out of it is actually the length of time it takes for the echo or for the stress wave generated by the hammer blow to travel down through the foundation and get reflected back to the receiver. If you make an estimate as to the velocity of that wave in the material that the foundation is constructed of, you can estimate the depth. So you're only getting that one piece of information out of this. Because of that, it's not good in complex soil strata or where the shaft cross-section varies, because each of these generates a reflection too, which can complicate the result and make it difficult to identify the true response from the base foundation that you're looking for. It also has a limited penetration depth. This is a very small amount of energy, and it gets dissipated as it travels down the shaft thanks to Poisson's ratio. The side friction on the shaft dissipates this energy. And typically in a soil like Boston or Chicago, medium to stiff clay, penetration depth of about 30 diameters is realistic. Anything more than that becomes very difficult. Principle is simple enough. The tap on the top of the shaft, as I said, there's the impact from the hammer. The wave travels down through the shaft and gets reflected back to the surface where it's detected by the receiver. So you measure that time. If you know the velocity of the wave, you can estimate the depth. Beyond about 30 diameters, you get nothing. The signal is completely damped out. There are some techniques that apply an amplification to the wave in this area, exponential amplification, to try and bring out the tow response. But the soil is a very noisy environment, particularly in a big city. So you're also amplifying all that noise, which again can make it very difficult to pick anything useful out of the signal. The impulse response method was developed to try and address some of the shortcomings of the echo test. In this method, the hammer is instrumented with a force transducer. So we now know the amount of force that's being put into the foundation, and the geophone is giving us the measurement of the velocity that we get back. So from that, we can do a network analysis and calculate things like the dynamic stiffness of the foundation and soil complex, and it gives us some clues as to the concrete quality. It's very sensitive to the shaft head condition because of the force transducer. If the head crumbles as we hit it, if the concrete's cracked or broken or contaminated, it'll distort the force measurement, and so it will skew the response when we try to calculate stiffness. It's still sensitive to surrounding soils in the same way that the impulse echo test is, and it's still not very good with multiple reflectors. Same limited penetration depth, but we get extra data because of the force measurement that enables us to do a frequency analysis where we get several pieces of information out of the curve instead of just the time. The slope at the beginning of the curve helps us calculate the dynamic stiffness of the pulse hole complex. Resonant peaks are reflections from, are generated by the reflection from the base. So the spacing between those enables us to calculate the depth of the that the reflections come from. The P to Q values here, the peak and trough values, are a function of the side friction on the shaft, of the damping of the shaft. And the location of the first peak relative to the origin, the phase of the signal, helps us to determine approximately how much of the bearing capacity is generated in end bearing and how much is in side friction. The mean height of the curve is a function of the cross-section area and the concrete density. The upper and lower bounds are marked here for typical upper and lower range of concrete quality. If the concrete is less dense than expected, this curve will rise. If it's more dense, the curve will be lower. Likewise, cross-section. If the cross-section is oversized, the mean amplitude will be low. If it's undersized, it will be high. So all that information can come out of a normal, out of a good test result. Even in complex irregular soils, we still get more information than we would expect to get from an echo test. The parallel seismic method. This was developed to work in situations where we can't take the get at the top of the shaft under an existing building or structure, for example. Historic structures, commonly in Chicago, they try to save a historic facade. So we need to know what's underneath it, but we don't want to damage the facade. So in cases like that, a borehole is sunk down beside the foundation, lined with a PVC tube that's filled with water, and then an acoustic receiver, a hydrophone, is lowered into the borehole. And we strike on the top of the foundation with a hammer to generate a sound wave that travels down through the foundation and radiates out to where it's detected by the receiver. It only estimates the foundation length. It's not an integrity test, but it's there to help us estimate the length of the foundation. Because we're measuring the time taken for that wave to travel down, and we know the distance from the amount of cable we've got in the hole, we can calculate the velocity, which helps us identify the foundation material. Timber, concrete, and steel all have very distinct velocity ranges. It was developed specifically to use on existing structures. Its cost is somewhat higher than the other tests because it needs the access tube drilled in beside the foundation. Because of that, it's also slower than the impulse echo or impulse response because the transducer is lowered in uniform increments down the shaft as we generate a hammer blow at each increment. So it's it takes quite a bit longer to perform. The kicker here is that it's a test that may be inconclusive in granular soils or film materials because we're relying on the propagation of the sound wave from the foundation to the access tube. Granular materials do not conduct sound as well as a cohesive material. So the test may be inconclusive in those conditions. The data is stacked for each hammer blow. We stack the data in this form. So there's the point of transmission, the impact, there's the point of reception. So again, we're measuring the time. As each blow is stacked, that time increases as we travel down the foundation in a uniform manner until we get past the bottom of the foundation, where the signal is now traveling through more soil. And so the time increases. And it's this inflection point that tells us roughly where the base of the foundation is. The resolution of the test depends on the spacing of your test increments. It's usual to perform an initial test at, say, 2 foot spacings, and then go back in and repeat it in this zone at 1 foot or 6 inch spacings to try and zero in a little bit on the where the base of the foundation may be. And across Ulsonic log method, usually in tubes that are pre-placed or pre-cast in the concrete, but it can be used in core holes in an existing structure. It's been used to evaluate dams, mass concrete foundations, and large diameter drilled shafts in this form. A transmitter and a receiver are lowered down adjacent bore holes, and the transmitter emits an ultrasonic pulse that travels through the concrete to the receiver. The test is repeated at discrete intervals as the transducers are raised up the shaft, so we can build up a vertical profile of the time, the transmission time through the concrete, which is a direct function of the concrete quality. Measuring the ultrasonic pulse velocity of the concrete, which is a function of the modulus and density of the material. The depth is limited only by the cables that you can lower down the hole. It has a good horizontal range, more than 10 feet for most modern equipment. So it can be used to assess things like slurry walls, and secant wall structures. It is, however, sensitive to the tube coupling to the surrounding concrete, which in the case of existing foundations isn't a problem because you're probably going to be working in core holes. But the test is performed in this manner, the point of transmission, the point of reception. So again, the time is what we're concerned about mostly. We get this waveform where the wave is received like a chirp. But if you're on the deep foundation and you're testing every 2 inches, you're going to get 500 or 600 of these chirps. So you want a way to present them where you can, you know, graphically put them on a sheet of paper and understand them. The easiest way to do it, or my preferred way anyway, is to do a rectification on the signal, where each positive peak is printed as a dash, each negative peak is a gap. So this dot dash line gives us all of the timing information and some of the amplitude information out of the raw curve. The lines of data are stacked consecutively as we come up the shaft. And so we build up this vertical profile of the time, transmission time through the concrete. Excuse my throat, sorry. So this helps us understand the concrete quality. Any significant reduction in concrete quality will result in the curve, these lines curving away to the right. And it's quite a graphic representation because we've measured, again, we know the depth of the probes in the tubes. So the depth measurement is quite accurate. Borehole gradiometer. This is a, like I say, a magnetic detection device that has its uses where there's steel involved, steel sheet piles, heavily reinforced drill shafts, etc. Radiometer can be used to try and detect the bottom of the foundation. I say try because there are other magnetic anomalies in soil, particularly where there's fill involved. So interpretation of the Schoenstatt is not a simple matter. Because of that, some people have tried to use radar in boreholes and on the surface. Problem with radar is that it's measuring the dielectric constant in the material, and any significant change in that dielectric constant generates a reflection. Steel embedded in concrete provides a very strong reflection, which, if you have grade beams or caps in place, it can help you identify where a foundation is, but you won't get get much information through the foundation because you're going to get reflections back from the steel. The antenna transmits microwave impulse, basically, down through the concrete. And it gets reflected back from changes in the dielectric constant, in this case, the reinforcing steel. Oops, we jump. And you can see here a very strong reflection from reinforcing steel, which creates a series of echoes and basically masks anything underneath. So you won't get any information about the underlying material in a heavily reinforced slab, grade B or gap. Assessment of sheet piles. This has been used successfully in a number of cases. In Chicago, for example, a redevelopment site included a sheet pile wall from the original earth retention works that the contractor wanted to reuse in his new excavations. But obviously he needed to know something about the depth and condition. We tried impulse and parallel seismic test results. Both were inconclusive. Impulse response, because the signal basically just got dissipated by the sheeting. The surface area relative to the cross-section area is so great that all the energy gets lost within a few feet. The parallel seismic tests showed a number of variations because there was fill material involved. We thought we saw a response from the base of the sheet, but we couldn't detect it reliably enough to be positive. So a borehole graniometer was used also, and that too produced a number of responses, but the strongest response did correlate with the response in the parallel seismic data. So based on that, the sheets were used. The potential savings on the project were about 100,000. There has been a number of failures using this method. A most notable one was a few years ago in the investigation of the levees in New Orleans following Hurricane Katrina. One of the levees had failed and it had a core of steel sheet piling in it that was suspect. So the Corps of Engineers and Louisiana State University both performed parallel seismic testing to assess the sheet piling and reported that the piles were about seven feet shorter than the design called for. Now, the contractor that put them in 1990 was confident in his work, so they went back there and they pulled several of the sheets and proved that they were, in fact, the correct length. So there was about a 30% error in the measurements estimated using the parallel seismic method. However, review of the soils in the area shows that there are several layers of shells, quite thick layers of shells in the subsoil. And that's, of course, a very granular material, which would almost certainly cause a loss of the parallel seismic signal. So it's very likely that the practitioners using the parallel seismic test didn't take into account soil conditions and as a result created an error that caused quite a lot of problems for the contractor until he went and physically pulled the piles out to prove them wrong. So all of these tests needed to be used with a good understanding of their operating principle and of the factors which are going to affect them. And not understanding those factors is going to lead to certainly inconclusive data and quite often lead you completely in the wrong direction. Case history number two was a baseball stadium expansion where the baseball team had got some extra income that they wanted to use. And so they wanted to put some boxes in, increase loading above the bleachers. And they needed to know what the existing foundations were, what load they could take, and would they be able to support the weight of the skyboxes, or would they have to put in new foundations? A couple of test pits were dug to check on the foundations, which were found to be concrete-filled steel pipe and believed to be step taper piles. Concrete samples were taken. Laboratory tests established the concrete strength to be within the normal range. And so the team decided to do some load tests using the structure itself for reaction mass to estimate the capacity. Testing cost was about $15,000 compared with the design proposal of 60 additional shafts at about $2,000 each, plus the cost of new pile caps and, of course, repairing the playing surface and all the other damage that would have occurred through such a major construction project. So total savings were estimated at $230,000. And of course, environmental savings would be not having to truck in equipment, materials, and burn all that diesel to drill the holes for 60 shafts. So it's difficult to put an actual number on it, but it certainly would have been a significant local effect. The test itself was fairly straightforward and gave us another opportunity to sample and do impulse testing on the shaft, because in the test pit, we sliced the lump out of it, put in the load test rig, and as I say, jacked it up using the existing structure as a reaction mass. Chicago is a lot like Boston in some ways, the soil particularly. As I said before, it's a complex soil structure, because there's five distinct glacial deposits through various ice ages that affected the area, overlying the dolomite bedrock. So a number of different foundation types evolved over the years, depending on the depth, the load required, and the depth they had to go to achieve the capacity they needed. The earlier concrete shafts achieved extra capacity by designing a bell, bearing on the various layers of the hard clays. There's stiff to hard clay, there's layers of dense sands and silts, and the Chicago hard pan, which is glacial till, over a rock, which again has got a layer of weathered rock over the top of the sound rock. So depending on the capacity wanted, the bells would go to various depths. The shaft could go to sit on rock, a shallow socket in the fractured rock, or a deep socket into the sound rock. Knowing which type was used is, of course, critical when trying to reuse the foundations. One of the earlier cases that I was able to find was by my employer, SDS Consultants, at that time, which was 111 South Wacker Drive in Chicago. The original building was built in 1962 for US Gypsum, and it was shuttered in the 1990s. The basement section was turned into a three-story parking lot, and it sat there for a couple of years until 2001. Redevelopment plans were made for the site to put in a 51-story high-rise, and the question of using the existing shafts came up, because it was known that the bell shafts, the shafts on the site were belled on hardpan, and they filled up most of the site. So there was very little room to put in new foundations. And so we needed to know, could we reuse the existing ones? The nice thing on this particular project was that the foundations were very well known. The design engineer at that time, the geotechnical engineer, was Clyde Baker. So he supervised the construction of the foundations for the gypsum building, and therefore had a great deal of confidence when he was asked to come up with foundations for the new 2001 51-story high-rise. One of the first things that were done was pressure meter tests to take a look at the capacity of the existing foundations. And Chicago codes have increased in allowable capacity over the years due to the amount of testing and construction verification that's been done over the last 40 to 50 years. So the pressure meter tests show that we could increase the capacity of the existing foundation from 16 KSF to 24 KSF, which was quite significant. Core samples were taken from several of the existing shafts to confirm concrete quality and uniformity. And in total, 25 shafts were reused in the main structure. So approximately, the shafts were various sizes. The existing ones ranged from 2.5 feet to 5 feet in diameter, and depths were around 40 to 50 feet. So approximately 500 cubic yards of spoil didn't have to be removed, and 500 yards of concrete didn't have to be trucked in. So there, are, again, is a huge environmental saving in a city with traffic as dense as Chicago's. Not having to use all those truckloads of material was significant. The final structure also reused the perimeter wall and caissons from the parking structure, and the total savings for the project was about $1 million, which apparently in the design phase turned out to be the critical factor as to whether the thing would be built or not. Another more recent example was Block 37 in Chicago, where a previous building of where the foundations were completely unknown, and a high-rise multi-use high-rise was going to be built. So again, the foundations need to be investigated. Combination of impulse response testing and core sampling confirmed that the shafts, in fact, extended to bedrock, and the concrete quality was good. A combination of ultrasonic pulse velocity testing horizontally through the top of the shaft and the impulse response data, the estimated depths the UPV data enabled us to come up with a velocity for the impulse response data and so refine our estimate of shaft depth, which correlated with the core samples and the bedrock depth. So again, a high degree of confidence the shafts were rock on top of rock. In total, 26 shafts were used in the new structure there, with a financial saving of more than $500,000. But the real kicker was the environmental saving. Reusing the 26 shafts, the contractor's estimate saved about 2,000 gallons of diesel fuel. The shafts were 5.5 feet diameter, 90 feet deep, so almost 80 yards per shaft. So over 200 truckloads of spoil didn't have to be hauled out. That's assuming you're using 40-ton trucks. And 230 truckloads of ready mix didn't have to be hauled in. So again, the savings were real and the environmental benefits were significant. So in conclusion, NDT methods can be helpful in obtaining the information you need for reuse of deep foundations, but you have to understand the method and its limitations. That's critical information. Otherwise, your expectations will not be met. An integrated approach, including the geotechnical information, will be needed for accurate interpretation of the test data. And all methods have limitations. I can't stress that enough. They're wonderful tests when used in the right conditions, but using the wrong test for the circumstances will at least at the best be misleading, be inconclusive, and at worst will be downright misleading. So that's all I have. Back to you, Gerald.